rights.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for giving me the honour of addressing this committee on such a crucial issue. To introduce my organisation briefly, European Digital Rights is an association of 27 digital civil rights associations from 17 European countries. I've worked with EDRI for 1 year, and prior to this I worked almost continually in the internet sector since 1995. I'd just like to address one part of this large directive, and that is internet blocking, because this point is central to EDRI's area of expertise. I would also like to point out, for fear of misunderstanding, that this is one part of a big directive, and my criticisms of the one article does not imply a criticism of the entire directive, which my colleagues here on the podium stress is so important. There are 4 points that I would like to address. I'd like to address 15 points, but I've got 10 minutes. The first point is that blocking leaves these crime scenes online, and there's no obvious benefit. The blocking entails real risks for child protection and for society at large. That the Commission made this proposal without a full and proper analysis. And finally, that the Commission's promise that blocking will be restricted to child abuse websites is already being broken. Firstly, the fact that blocking leaves these crime scenes online. To explain briefly, blocking is a generic term. There are different types of blocking, and indeed the blocking supported by the Internet Watch Foundation is different from the blocking supported by, for example, the Swedish authorities. There are basically very generally two types of blocking. The most common type involves the consumer's traffic to particular websites being hijacked and redirected by their internet service provider. This approach is so technically flawed that privacy-enhancing technologies promoted by the European Commission can often circumvent it without the consumers even being aware of it. However, other more invasive technologies also exist, such as deep packet inspection. This technology involves looking inside all citizens' private communications to identify suspect material. Despite its invasiveness, however, even that technology's scope is limited by encryption. Oddly, after months of discussion, there is still no evidence as to which type of blocking the Commission expects, and indeed, once the directive is implemented, the Commission has got no particular control over what technology member states will consider to be adequate. So blocking does not work because when blocking is implemented, the websites remain online. People using many of the valuable and legitimate privacy-enhancing technologies supported by the European Commission will circumvent many types of blocking without even trying. Blocking does not even address the majority of child abuse, which is on other platforms such as peer-to-peer. And of course, as Mr. Selstrom pointed out, everyone outside the jurisdiction of the country imposing the so-called block is also unaffected. It is clear that the possible gains from this approach, therefore, are extremely limited. Blocking obviously does nothing to stop deliberate access, and it cannot do anything to stop accidental access because the problem is so small. Fewer than one person out of every 3,000 active internet users report illegal material in any given year. Blocking might also slightly disrupt commercial sites, but it could also help commercial sites because once they detect they've been blocked, they can move on to another server in another country. Blocking leaves websites online and has no proven benefit. Second point I'd like to raise are the real risks for both child protection and for society at large. There are different types of risks involved in blocking for society, for child protection, and for the EU's international credibility. We can already see the waste of resources. We already have people preparing a worst of the worst list rather than fighting the crime itself. Almost all such sites, which are grave, apparent abuses, are almost all hosted on the territories of our major trading partners. Compare the extent and energy of the EU's efforts on negotiating international trade agreements and compare these with our international efforts on preventing child abuse online. We also face a major risk that blocking will prolong the inaction of the Member States. In the impact assessment, the Commission justified the need for this directive, saying that we can't trust the Member States to implement the Council of Europe Convention quickly enough or comprehensively enough. In such circumstances, the worst thing to do is to promote a measure which allows Member States to hide their inaction. But this is exactly what was done. If blocking makes it appear that something is being done to fight child abuse online, we all know that pressure will be reduced to take more effective measures, will be redeployed to any number of other problems which are also urgent. The proposal also brings with it the entirely inevitable spread of blocking to other areas, as we already see in some Member States. Blocking is already being used to try to protect national gambling monopolies and media multinationals in several European countries. There is also a cost in technology creep, as more and more invasive technologies will be demanded by big business to control access to the internet. Blocking will damage the EU's credibility as we campaign internationally for freedom of information. How can we campaign for freedom of information in a few years when we have implemented a comprehensive blocking infrastructure that will be used, that is being used, in a vain attempt to protect gambling monopolies and music multinationals, and to hide our inability to protect the weakest members of our society? There is also a cost in prioritising an approach for which there is so little evidence that the Commission chose not to assess its impact in countries where it has already been implemented. The risks of blocking are too high. We must not implement an unproven technology which will be used by Member States to prolong years of international inaction. Comprehensive, effective international actions and not symbolic measures are needed to fight online child abuse. This proposal entails real risks for both child protection and for society at large. Third point I would like to raise is the preparatory work that has been done by the European Commission. The European Commission introduced impact assessments to improve the quality and coherence of the policy development process and to contribute to an effective and efficient regulatory environment. This policy area needs quality, coherence, efficiency and effectiveness. But how efficient and effective does the European Commission want to be in this case when it proposed blocking without attempting to assess the impact in countries where it already exists, without assessing the possible impact of international activities, such as the new dialogue on the USA on this issue, and the likely impact on proportionality of the measure, without assessing specifically why the websites remain online? And on this point, I'd like to point to the press release of the German Arca Zensur that did some analysis on this. The Commission also didn't assess the rapidly diminishing relevance of blocking due to, as Mr. Robbins pointed out, the ever-increasing proportion of child abuse material that's hosted on hacked servers that's being put on innocent photo-sharing websites, and the increasing problem that sites are simply moving too quickly to be put on a blocking list. The target for blocking is getting smaller and smaller, and we've got no assessment of where the borderline for proportionality might be. The Commission hasn't been clear about the purpose of the blocking measure, whether it's for accidental access, for deliberate access, or for some other purpose. The Commission hasn't assessed the technical limitations of blocking. A recent report for the OSCE said that the limitations are so grave as to potentially render the entire approach illegal under the European Convention on Human Rights. The Commission didn't assess the danger that sites would be blocked instead of being investigated, as appears to be the case based on feedback from several owners of innocent blocked websites. And the Commission also didn't address this point in its subsidiarity statement. These major oversights have major consequences, and the danger of unintended consequences are real. For example, like many of the voices in this debate, the intellectual property lobby in Denmark demanded that a particular website be blocked. They said it was important to be seen to be doing something, that any action would be a step forward. Without any regard for effectiveness, proportionality, or unintended consequences, the blocking order was made. Traffic to that website immediately went up by 12%. The inevitable leaking and hacking of child abuse blocking lists risks driving traffic to the abuse sites in the same way. In the commercial world, experimentation with unproven policy options that undermine fundamental rights is unwelcome and it's damaging. In the world of child protection, such experimentation is simply reckless and dangerous. Worse still, once implemented, it will be almost impossible to repeal. Having given the inaction of member states as a reason for proposing this directive, the Commission did not assess if blocking would reinforce this inaction. Having seen blocking in place in several countries, the Commission did not assess if it had any practical value. Having seen blocking spread to gambling monopolies and media multinationals, the Commission promised that what is happening will not happen. This is simply not good enough. The Commission's promise that blocking will be restricted to child abuse websites is already being broken. It would be nice to believe the Commission's promise when it says that this is about child abuse images and nothing else. However, the Commission itself is funding at least two projects which aim to block other content, regardless of how the Parliament votes. The last Council presidency adopted a paper supporting the use of blocking to protect gambling monopolies. Member states such as Bulgaria, Denmark, France, Italy and Lithuania all have or are planning to extend blocking to try to protect large commercial interests. It is painfully clear, therefore, that the promise of the Commission is not being kept by the Commission itself, by the Council or by the Member States. In conclusion, I implore this Commission to reflect very carefully on all of these points and to propose a text which respects subsidiarity, which respects the rule of law, and which does not allow Member States to abdicate responsibility by outsourcing the problem to private companies. We have one request from this Parliament, that the directive require Member States to act against actual crimes. They can no longer be allowed to hide behind their inaction and empty promises. Blocking must be removed from this proposal. I urge you to adopt a text which places clear and enforceable obligations on Member States to finally do what they promised to do in the Child Rights Convention, in the Optional Protocol to the Child Rights Convention, in the Council of Europe Convention, in the Stockholm Declaration, in the Yokohama Global Commitment. Empty promises are no longer enough.